son of a bitch.
Marty Jannetty, no, I hit you with the drop kick. Marty Jannetty, no, I hit you with the drop kick. Marty Jannetty, no, I hit you with that drop kick. Marty Jannetty.
Let me do this again.
No, it's live, pal.
Oh, we're live, pal.
Damn right, we're live, pal. Welcome into the latest edition of Hot Tag Wrestle Kona, coming at you live from downtown Cleveland. I'm one half your host. I'm Rob.
I'm Clint.
Got a good show for you today. Our typical show, going through last week's week of pro wrestling. We're gonna skip Dark Side. Both still catching up on that a little bit, so we're replacing that with a very funny and interesting Mount Rushmore we have for you this week. But as always, as our typical show, we're gonna start off with the news this week. Both have some interesting news stories. Let's get started with them. Pleno, what you got for me?
Alrighty.
There you go. Oh, crap. Got the pins off.
Don't worry about it. Gotcha. Go ahead.
All right. Thank you. All right. News story number one we're going to start off with. Vince McMahon had to undergo some surgery. He had to undergo surgery last week to fix an issue with his spine. The surgery lasted more than 4 hours, but it was a success. He is recovering now. So, that's one we start with. Speaking of Vince McMahon, Nails gives his side of the McMahon attack and refutes the claims of all the other talents. So, y'all know he was infamous for attacking Vince in 1992. He got fired after attacking him in a locker room over a dispute of pay, ended up choking him. He filed a wrongful termination suit and laid that McMahon sexually assaulted him in a counterclaim. Both claims were dropped. So if it had anything to do with payments, he said usually a guy wouldn't quit or have a problem with the ownership of a business if he was happy what he was getting paid. Sums it up there. Dean was asked about on Bruce Pritchard claimed that he called Vince in his home and Vince said he had talked to him at TV. He said it never happened. He don't even know how he got his number. Jimmy Hart claiming that he was in the room in the accident. He said no, was nobody in the room except me and the assailant. On Bret Hart saying that he was down the hall from the attack. He like, I don't know who was outside in the hall because we were in the locker room and the door was shut. I didn't go to the phone and call the police and said I've been assaulted. On John Norris saying that he was asked by Nails to watch the door and pretend to pull him off someone. He said no, that didn't happen. Now you basically refuting a lot of people that said that they had. What did the counter what happened? He's on the reaction from the talent. He said, I'm really not around wrestling anymore for probably a good 20 years. From what I heard from people, a lot of people didn't like what I did to the guy in the East Coast. They understand. They have to understand we're independent contractors. And everyone makes their own deal. What deal works for them may not work for me. The deal that I was told didn't come through. A lot of guys think that was stupid for what he did. He should have never did it or whatever. They make their own deals. I make my own deals. And my deals didn't come through. They asked him if he wished that the night would have happened differently. He said, no, I'm fine with what happened. I don't have regrets. He said, never got too many thank you calls and thank you letters in my life. He said, people ended up working for him later with the same guy that came and thanked him for what happened. He said, stepped on a lot of toes and made it tough for a lot of people. He made promises he didn't fulfill. He said they were in a bad predicament because he lied to them. He said that's their deal, not mine. I'm only speaking of what happened to me. What happened to me didn't come through. So refused a lot of claims. Said I don't regret it.
He doesn't regret lying.
He said he don't regret the whole
incident. Lying on the stand and trying to get this man put in jail.
He said he don't regret the whole incident.
Okay, gotcha. All right.
Next couple of stories involving Kurt Angle. Kurt Angle talk about why Gene Snitsky didn't go no further in WWE and gets his thoughts on the Divas search. He said Gene was a nice kid, but he didn't know wrestling well. And even if he wasn't no good, it was that he had no confidence whatsoever. He was always nervous. And when he did, he'd clam up. Said he was good when he got in the ring, but it was just when the TVs was on, it was just like he got too nervous. he was tight and nervous, so he said a nervous stiff could set you back up when you freeze up and you're nervous. So he basically saying like he was nervous. He talked about Christy Hemme. He said she was talented. She made a name for herself on the Diva Search. She was awesome, and she continued to be awesome during her WWE career and into TNA. He also talked about the Diva Search had to be done. It had to be done, no if or buts. They're going to do this, so they might as well enjoy watching it because it's going to happen. To infuse and find more female talent, I guess. Yeah, they definitely was trying to find talent. They found a lot of great talent. I don't know about that last part because I don't think hardly none of them ever was named. Next, Kurt Angle said Hulk Hogan is the biggest name in wrestling history. And he gave his thought on Hulk Hogan. So he said he's the biggest name in the history of professional wrestling. You get the opportunity to get in the ring with him, and you better put on a 5-star performance. At this part that got me. He said at this point in his career, Hulk Hogan could still go. I mean, I'm not going to tell you that he was quick and flashy. But he got the job done, and he continued to say, yeah, he's not Lucha Libre. He's not Rey Mysterio who's doing hurricanranas off the top rope. He never was. That wasn't his style. That's not who he is. But listen, fans pop for him. He still knows what he's doing in the ring.
All right.
And then he goes on about Maria Kanellis. Nobody else will be talking about that. Your face says it all.
Because I'm wondering, like, did somebody, like, specifically ask about these people? Because, like, who gives a fuck about Kanellis and fucking Snitsky at this point? Like, my question is relevancy at this point. Like,
he said Maria.
Or he's just randomly bringing the people on his podcast or some shit.
He said Maria is great. He said she was great at what she did. She played the dope. She know how to do that, but she could be intelligent. She could be smart. She can just be a lot different emotions. She's real. She's really good at what she does. And I like her at the interview position. And by the way, yes, this was on his podcast. So
I kind of figured.
Yeah, because he just randomly talking about Gene Snitsky and Maria Kanellis. Like,
that's all I was saying. Like, really? Relevancy. Like, that was your era. Yeah, they worked when you worked. But, like,
I don't know.
Maybe somebody asked him a question.
R. Anderson explained why he's not a big fan of the Royal Rumbles. Throws his heap pray that Jim Ross has a broadcaster. He basically said it simple. And you have battle royals. If you've seen one, you've pretty much seen them all. It's the Royal Rumble being different from a battle royal. he also says that he talked about Jim Ross as an announcer and WCW departure, you know, because he was announced for WCW.
Yeah.
And he said, well, one of the things he said was true after. Not only was he excited, but what he called was correct. The moves were right. The story was right. Right. He led your eyes to see what they were seeing, but he filled it with an explanation. And to this day, he does the same thing. He explained everything to the naked eye. He said, I don't think he achieved what he would achieve. He hadn't done any talent relations stuff. So, you know, it might be one of those things that fate took him there. If he would have stayed in WCW, he may have stayed as an announcer, and that probably was it. And then maybe the guys on the other end of WWF would have suffered because of it. So, that's on that. He details on how to lay out a long match. And he basically said he had to break it down into increments. First, he must get control before the 10-12 minute mark, go back and forth. Babyface drop for position, babyface gets stopped, then you got a good chunk of 5, 6, 7 minutes of where the heels are controlling, cut off the ring. Then he said the trick is to get peaked and stop that babyface. Then you get second heat that the first babyface can recover. Now the audience don't know which way it's gonna go. You normally had to finish off the hot tag, that's one hot tag, but you're going 30 minutes, you must break it down to increments and get a second tag, do the same thing over. Four way, whatever it is, break it down the strategy into chunks of time and stories. He also talked about why a lot of people said Vader was Sting's biggest rival. And he said because Vader made it competitive. You know, no matter how you slice it, he was big and impressive and a hell of an athlete. And for him to go out there and make Sting was his job, mind you, some guys that size would felt like they had to work a lot stronger. Leon knew what his job was, and he could have made it happen. He could have had a match with anybody. That one was a shocker to me. Man, he think Vader was his biggest rival.
I can understand the opinion, though.
Yeah.
They had a good run against each other, exchanging the title back in, like, 93.
Yeah, I'm gonna get right down. Come on, as we wind down. Ric Flair believed that Logan Paul is better than 70% of the WWE roster. This was he was speaking with Scott Thompson on Fox News Digital. He said the only two athletes prior to him, he said, was Brock Lesnar, Kurt Angle, and of course, you know, he said his daughter. He said, I can't name 10. He said, I can name 3. He said, if Logan Paul commits himself to it, he's better than 70% of the full-time guys. He said he loved that he's willing to take risks. He's willing to do shit that had never been done before. Same guy that's selling mushroom fused energy drinks for $30.
It's a pack of them for $30. You it's like 6 for 30. It's not one. Now, I understand if you do the fucking math on that. That's like,
it's a lot.
It is. It's like good fuck, $5.50 a bottle, something like that. It's up there. But my math is probably off on that. But either way, for the six pack, it's a little under $6 per bottle. Let's put it that way.
Let's see. I got three more. One is Vaughn Grayson Waller still talking shit at The Rock. He said that The Rock is out of work due to the SAG AFTRA strike, so he need to show up to SummerSlam next month. Mom, he also said that The Rock using the same insults he's been used for 15 years ago. And when I was 15, they were funny. It's an open invitation to the Grayson Waller effect. Come on the show. Your daughter's in a cult right now at NXT. And your family's in shambles on the main show. So you need to be worried about Grayson Waller. We have to do something about it. There are so many legends in town for SummerSlam. Then he also said he heard that The Undertaker might be in town. He shouldn't worry about Stone Cold Steve Austin. He said it's up to The Rock. He made any claims about a busy schedule, but I don't know if he have a busy schedule now. You wake up at 4 a.m. to work out. You're done by 6 a.m. You have a whole day free. I'm open. He can say whatever he want. It'll be a lot of fun. We'll see if Dwayne has anything to say. So, yeah, he's still talking mad shit. Last two. LA Knight reportedly is rubbing people the wrong way backstage. So he's getting this push, but Vince McMahon has been a fan of LA Knight. Triple H has been a fan of NXT. You talk about that.
My bad, real quick. My math was fucking terrible there, and I need to correct myself. It was $5 a bottle for a six pack. It was $30, so got it. I don't know what the fuck I was thinking there. My bad.
It might be that tax.
Might be the weed. Go ahead.
They was talking about releasing him last year when he was in the Maximum Male Model group, but a lot of people, Shawn Michaels, one of the main people, also pushed for him to. They feel like Shawn Michaels like fought hard for LA Knight to stay, like not get released.
So my question is, how is Puma Asics rubbing people? Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Okay. So
they dummy.
They say his push can be derailed because of the reputation of incorrectly rubbing people the wrong way. He's also
So basically, not to cut you off there. So basically, like Mr. Kennedy,
basically,
because he did the same
basically,
shit.
Basically, yeah,
rubbed the wrong person the wrong way, who went and snitched on his ass.
They say he's also bad. His push. They also say he's bad at backstage politics. And they say he's on course to get a high level push because of how he connects with the fans. But if his push fizzle out, it's because of his backstage behavior, not because they just like gave up on him. So,
all right.
And last one, Cody Rhodes. You know he reeled his rules about using moves that belong to other wrestlers. He said, Booker T in the corner, Jerry Lynn does it. He said, I'll do the spin over to a sunset flip. He said, my rule is if I wrestle you more than 5 times, I can do all your stuff. It's only my rule. He said, people hate it. He said, people love the Cody cutter. He said, I think it's better than the Oz cutter, but I got it from Will, so fair play to Will, who's super talented. He said, aside from Osprey, he mentioned like all the stuff he did from Booker T and R. Anderson. He said he stole moves from Jay Lethal one time. He said, Jerry does the Booker role. Well, it's a couple of R. Anderson things that I find it hard to visualize. It's something else I just try to put into the nightmare package. So if you wrestle Cody Rhodes 5 times, then
he can
steal your shit. So Seth Rollins, you ain't wrestled him 5 times yet, but wrestle him 2 more times, he'll steal your curb stomp. He'll steal your stump. Brock Lesnar, I don't think he'll steal your F5. Five, but probably your Kimura or something. That's all my news stories. Yay. All
right, so let's get started with mines. I'll save that one for last. Let's start off with All In, which will be here in about a month, exactly August 27th. So it's talking about some rumored matches for it, some that have not been confirmed yet, but like I said, they're rumors for a reason. Kota Ibushi has been rumored to possibly tag team with Kenny Omega in a match against Chris Jericho and Konosuke Katachka, or you could see Chris Jericho possibly taking on Jericho. Did I say Jericho taking on Jericho?
Yeah.
Okay, my bad. I'm going to say Jericho taking on Will Ospreay as opposed to Kenny Omega, which you still need to see a third in the trilogy between their matches from this year that both have been incredible and both have been match of the year status so far. Also rumored to be in on All In or All Out, Darby Allin versus Luchasaurus for the TNT title. Also, Jon Moxley possibly versus Orange Cassidy, and of course, for the AEW title, well, I believe this one should probably be on All Out. MJF versus Adam Cole, and also possibly CM Punk versus Ricky Starks are matches that are possible to make up some of these upcoming pay per views in the next about a month or so from now. Next up, well, that's basically the same thing. Ospreay's rumor match for All In, which we just talked about with Jericho. CM Punk reportedly wants Roosh and AEW on Collision. Note on WWE interest in Roosh. Recent reports on Instagram, CM Punk shared a photo of Roosh and put the words Colliders on it, according to Wrestling Observer Newsletter. Punk has been pushing for Roosh to be on Saturday's show going forward. As previously noted, Roosh signed a new deal with AEW earlier this week. Meanwhile, it was noted AEW did offer more than WWE offered Roosh, who had interest. Also, it was said it was insane amount of money from WWE. So for AEW to match it means he got some insane amount of money right now.
Yeah.
No matter what. WWE wanted to bring him into NXT and plan to offer him more than most NXT wrestlers except for Gable Stevenson, who also turned down possibly a chance at the Olympics to stay in NXT. That's a sidebar story, but I'm not going to get into that. AEW offered more than what they were targeting. It should be noted that WWE never officially became made to El Toro Blanco. It was just discussed. Next up, note on how long Jim Ross has left on his AEW contract. Previously reported, Jim Ross noted on his podcast he didn't have a lot of time left on his AEW contract. He said his goal was to be healthy enough for him to call All In at Wembley Stadium. Newsletter reports that Ross currently has 2 months left on his deal. He currently has no set date to return to the company, but it's believed he'll be back on Collision when he does. So my guess is he would be the lead on Collision in the same spot that Ian Riccoboni's been in the last 2 weeks, who's been filling in. I forgot my guy's name. Kevin Kelly. He's been filling in for Kevin Kelly, who been the first voice on AEW Collision. Also, Jim Ross was on that first episode, but kind of had a real raspy voice, and he's kind of been out since then. So I'm guessing this would be more of his vehicle he can be on once he does come back. And I hope they do re-sign Jim Ross, whether it be on camera or in the backstage role, or if he's ready to retire due to health reasons. I can understand that too, but if he can still go on, I hope they keep him because he's an asset to the company, and I love Jim Ross.
JR is one of those rare people I feel like he should have contracts from all companies. He can go wherever the hell he wants. Wherever he go. He has limited assets.
They just loan him out like a car. Like, all right, you got Jim Ross.
You make it sound bad.
I know when I say it like that, it does sound fucking terrible.
It sounds horrible, but like.
It does sound terrible in that way. My bad, y'all. I wasn't shitting on JR. I love you, JR. Anyway, moving on. The latest on the Elite's contract status in AEW. A Wrestling Observer Newsletter also reports that it's currently believed the AEW and the Elite are going to resign with the company. The Young Bucks and Kenny Omega have expiring deals at the end of the year, and it's believed that Hangman Page's also contract is in negotiations. I remember Omega talking specifically, saying basically, the best moments of my career have been tied to having you guys in my corner and as my friends, so I follow as you go, basically is what he was saying. So where if y'all decided to go jump over to the WWE, then I'm gonna follow you. He said, you staying here, then this we doing when you staying here, basically what he had to say. The angle that it happened at Blood and Guts that did not air on television was reportedly meant to be on TV. This included Blackpool Combat Club shaking hands with the Golden Elite, as well as a promo from Omega. In that promo, Omega mentioned that he would be sticking together with the rest of the Elite, which led to the rumors about the group status. However, no one involved with the segment that has said that was Omega meant was what he had said. WWE reportedly thought at one point they had a good shot at getting Omega in 2024. And at the time, he was the talent they wanted the most, including Jay White or any others that were free agents. Since then, the talks have died down. They believe he will stay in AEW. Next up, Vince McMahon reportedly behind some recent nicknames in WWE, or what we call here the slave name. Several wrestlers have new nicknames in WWE, like, for example, Seth freaking Rollins. That's Vince written all over that one.
I like that one, though.
Here's some new ones. Dirty Dominic Mysterio.
I hate that one. Dirty Dom. It makes sense when Rhea says it, but I just don't.
No, I don't like that one.
Big Bronson Reed.
That was dumb as fuck. When I heard it, I'm like, really? Y'all put a big in front of the man's name?
I mean, it's obvious.
I mean, but yeah, though. Like, yeah, it didn't seem a big
one. You put that shit on the fucking tee for Vince. Of course he's going to hit that shit out the fucking park right there. He's like, oh, fat guy, got to call him big, yeah. While Reed and Mysterio have their nicknames on TV, others have had their names mentioned by the announcers, like the Hellions from Hades, which they call Judgment Day, Spirited Sami Zayn, Scintillating Santos Escobar.
Oh my God.
Cheeky Chelsea Green. You're cutting it kind of close there.
Cheeky.
And the self-aggrandizing Sonya Deville. It hasn't been pushed as hard on
SmackDown. Don't push them last five last names, please.
It hasn't been pushed as hard on SmackDown as it's been pushed on Raw.
Don't push them last five nicknames, please.
So, next story. AEW reportedly filed a trademark for AEW Plus. PWI Insider reports that on July 24th, AEW have filed a new trademark for the term AEW Plus, which includes streaming services. The filing is for goods and services, streaming of professional wrestling entertainment video material on the internet. This should be noted that AEW Plus is the name of the company's international subscription service that's on Fight. There's no word on whether this will be used for something else. I'm assuming this could be their version of the WWE Network, where you can get their old stuff, like the first shows they came out with in 2019 and stuff and everything. You know, all the pandemic era stuff. That was out of Jacksonville. Next up, Jeff Hardy says Rampage is the B show to get back on Dynamite. Jeff Hardy mostly has been in AEW Rampage since he returned to the company from his suspension, so he's hoping to move back on Dynamite eventually. Hardy only has competed once on Dynamite since he returned to the company. And in an interview with Muscle Man Malcolm, he talked about his goals and more. You can check out a few of his highlights below. Quote, he was saying of being on Rampage, yeah, it's kind of like being on the B show, but you can go out there and still get the people what they want, and they get their money's worth. But naturally, the ultimate goal for me and Matt is the AEW World Tag Team Championships. I'm making a wave towards the title shots. Quote, now that I'm coming out for that, which means it's within my reach, so we're using Rampage moments to hopefully eventually create huge Dynamite moments. I'm wanting their last run as world champion. Quote, It's the one of the goals I've set for myself before, and as I've said it,
delete that
as goal. It's all said and done. To look back and say, yeah, you came out on your own personal hell to achieve a world championship within your own personal heaven once again.
You celebrate all your bro got that for like 3 minutes.
So that would just make everything compete. Look, to what you were saying, if you're going to do that, you got to stop. When he's getting jumped, you got to stop coming out and being like, It was the fucking funniest, bro. I was like, hell no.
He was there like, get in, like, that beat down here.
Like, he wasn't getting his ass whooped.
And that's on top of that, funny. You talking about you got all these aspirations for championships. Sorry. No offense, not going to happen. Two, it's the B. You call it the B show, but it's your own fault you're down there. Okay? As soon as you sign with AEW, you got what, DUI? Like
within 2 weeks.
2 weeks of being with the company. Like, it's your own fault, bro.
I agree. So moving on from the Jeff Hardy craziness, here's my last story. Salty bitch delivering more salty shit. So as we recently have reported about Sergeant Slaughter.
I don't have it this time. He's a real, real bitter guy.
Sergeant Slaughter was salty about the fact that WWE let's
do like the
Lacey DeVille use
Lacey Evans.
I said Lacey DeVille. Sorry. That's actually a smut star. Sorry. Lacey Evans. Let her use the Cobra Clutch and also let Million Dollar Man use it back in the day, and neither time did they ask him.
He's also bitter about the fact that Undertaker ain't invite him to the Hall of Fame. Talking about he discovered him.
And all this other shit. Lately. So in this story, he went out and trademarked his ring name and finisher for various items so that way nobody else can use it without them asking him. PWI Insider reports that WWE Hall of Famer and former champion Sergeant Slaughter recently applied for a trademark for his in-ring name for various items, including collectible coins, action figures, comics, and more. You can check out the recent trademark filings that were listed. Coins. So here's the trademark filings. Collectible coins. Entertainment services, namely live appearances by professional wrestling and sports entertainment celebrities. Entertainment services, namely personal appearances by professional wrestling and sports entertainment personalities. Entertainment services, namely wrestling exhibits and performances by professional wrestlers and entertainers, meaning like shows and like cons and stuff like that. Printed comic books, magazines, and professional wrestling field. Printed trademark cards and others for games. Printed comic magazines, coffee mugs, headwear, namely hats, sweatshirts, wearable garments and clothing, namely shirts and action figures.
Nobody wearing that much Sergeant Slaughter shit. Okay?
And action figures, toys, dolls, trademarking for cards, games, model plastic toy figurines. He also
he basically just saying you can't use the name at all.
He additionally applied the trademark to his finisher, the Cobra Clutch, for the for the same
for
the same categories.
I was waiting for it. He's gonna mention the Cobra Clutch. He's gonna bring it up eventually.
He recently had a chat at San Diego Comic Con about his career and new game WrestleQuest. All right.
No practice.
No, that's the end of news. So let's get into this Mount Rushmore. So I decided to have a funny one after hearing a podcast earlier this week about sports songs. You know, I like this podcast called Crime and Sports, and I got their Patreon recently, and their Patreon episode I was listening to was about sports songs, and there were some pretty funny ones. The 49ers had a pretty shitty one from the 80s. The Dodgers had a pretty shitty one from the 80s. So did the Mets. Let's get mesmerized.
That was God.
It was shitty as fuck.
That same team, that 1916 made a CD. Jay Spoley tried to. Daryl Strawberry and all them guys trying to rap.
So it rolled over into wrestling songs, and then that led us to our list here. So our list today for our Mount Rushmore is our Mount Rushmore of the worst wrestling songs of all time. Now, these are not theme songs, mind you. We're not saying that. We'll have that list down the line. What we're saying here is these songs were the wrestler performed on the song himself. Not Jim Johnson, not them hiring out somebody to do the song, like with the CFO cats with WWE, or if they like licensed the song out from an actual song like Saturday Night's All Right for Fighting for AEW Collision. We're not talking about that. We were talking about the wrestler singing the song or singing their own theme song. Now, I rearranged the order of my lists because we have the same on one of them. So that way we could just do that as one selection. But other than that, we have completely different picks for all four of these outside of one. So let's start with the honorable mentions, and we're going to play a little clip of everything we have here. I'm going to start with mine because I already got it loaded up. Or I had it loaded up. I have a different one loaded up that has the same person that's on both. So my number four and my honorable mention are both the wrestler being The Rock. My honorable mention of these is a song. My honorable mention for these is a song called Face Off. It's a Tech N9ne song, and The Rock's on it, you know what I'm saying? And I'm going to try to skip ahead to The Rock's verse on here, just because I can't explain it. It's like, his flow is cool, but like, I don't know if it's like, I don't believe him.
You don't believe him.
Or I don't feel like,
a lot of people
like what he's saying.
A lot of people like, it got wrote for him. A lot of people feel like Tech N9ne wrote like his body. What's the name for him?
Let's get to the, yo, let me jump ahead King to The Rock. Bro.
What's poppin', bro?
They gon' take your face off. They gon' rumble. They gon' take your face off. They gon' rumble. They gon' take your face off.
Here comes The Rock.
It's about drive, it's about power. We stay hungry, we devour. Put in the work, put in the hours, and take what's ours. Like in some...
Okay, so we don't get demonetized. I'm only going to play 10 seconds or so. But, yeah. That part wasn't necessarily, his bars weren't necessarily cheese. It's just like, I don't know, bro. You got a lot of pots in the fire, brother. This was a surprise to me that you had time to write bars. You know what I'm saying? You making movies and shit. You like the highest paid movie star that's out here. You out here messing with the UFC. You branded with the shoes and shit. You out here to present motherfuckers with the BMF title, which I won't be surprised if he comes out tonight presenting that motherfucker tonight too. You do a lot. So I didn't know bars was also on the list. So I'm just confused. And then you also fit that in with those fucking wild ass Sunday where you eat anything you fucking want. Jesus. All right. So that was my honorable mention. Okay. So your honorable mention, you want to talk about it? Go ahead.
Okay.
As I pull it up.
Okay. So my honorable mention, I like the song. I just don't, the CD was just trash.
The song is classic.
The song is classic though, but the CD was trash. And also, to every time we do something like with songs, it's not a word song. I just feel like I just want this song here. That's why I kind of put it as my honorable mention.
So, you want to say it or you want me to just play it? Because I got it loaded.
Oh, go ahead.
I'm
you
ready
just
to
play
go.
It.
All right.
Go ahead, play
here
it.
Here we go. Here we go.
The people don't know what it is.
Whatever they call you, I'm coming after you.
That's the part that killed me, bro. That's the part that killed me. So this is it. He ready to jump on them bars, bro. Be a man. A macho man. Oh, my God.
That song sucked, though. But that song is a classic, though.
Oh, my God. That was funny. That was fucking funny. So I had to go there. Okay. All right.
Okay.
That's a preview of my number four of my official list. So the one of these that, this is when I really was young and I started to actually realize that these things existed. Like, I was 14. I didn't really know about Pile Driver. Like, Pile Driver came out, I was like 4 or 5. Like, I wasn't checking for that. So I remember one day I was watching, I think it might have been TRL era, so MTV or BET. And a video came on Watch Left, and this is around the time that he had came out with that Maria song with Santana.
Yeah.
This is around that same time. So
Watch Left was hot.
Now, he didn't actually have bars on the song, but he has a feature credit on the song, so it counts. Let's play a little bit of this.
So it counts.
It does count.
And you're about to smell what The Rock is cooking.
I'm gonna cut up and scoot ahead a little bit.
I got a pocket full of cheese and a garden full of trees.
It doesn't matter.
I just won the bingo, bought a crib in Rio.
It doesn't matter.
But if you ain't sharing, people ain't caring. Come up in the hood and then take everything you're wearing.
It doesn't matter.
That was his feature on the song. So at least on Face Off, he actually got a verse. Here he just got, it doesn't matter.
Like, oh my God.
That's all he gets on that one.
Oh my God.
All right, so let's get to your number four, man.
Oh, man.
Back to your man, Mach. Mach.
Okay. This song, it seemed like It's somebody that's trying to give you life advice while you're on a trip, but he's tripping himself too, though.
On acid?
Yeah.
All right, so let's play a little bit of this one.
The Tower of Power, too sweet to be sour, funky like a monkey. Ooh, yeah.
The beat.
Get down! Get down!
Let me hit that.
Let's skip ahead a little bit. Let's hear some good voice. Macho Man gets the party jumping. I ain't know if y'all knew that.
He's really quite amazing. He's the Macho Man.
I'm the Macho Man, Randy Savage. Doing the thing in the ring.
It doesn't even rhyme.
Macho.
Oh my God.
He'd be feeling himself on that one, man.
Yeah. All right, so we're back to me. All right, so my number three is just because I love shitting on this song because I hated this fucking wrestler over the years. And the other one, Jim Curran, shit on him every show. every chance we get, we shit on this guy. So this one is a tie. For this one.
Oh, God.
Alright, so my first of the tie was Honky Tonk Man.
I like that song.
He sung his own theme song. It was cool. It was called Cool Cock Bad, I guess. I get that.
Honky Tonk Man.
Sideburns and my hair slick back. I'm coming to your town and my feet get like I'm just a honky tonk man.
He's a honky tonk man.
I'm just a honky tonk man.
He's a honky tonk man.
I'm just a honky tonk man.
All right, that's as much of that crap as I can stand or want to
play.
Hey,
man. Hey, fun fact, you know who Peggy Sue was?
Wasn't she with Deuce and Domino later or something like that?
No, Peggy Sue was for Sacramento Sherry.
Oh, yeah. That is right. Okay, I shouldn't do that. Okay. All right, and then that's a tie with our other favorite to hate on. Though he's earned my affection over the years. I still can't stand his fucking ass. All right, Jeff Jarrett, Be My Baby Tonight.
Oh.
Wait, hold on. That's a different one. Oh, no, it is With My Baby Tonight. This is With My Baby, not Be My Baby Tonight. That is fucking slap nuts himself right there.
Finger!
Be weather.
With my baby tonight. All right, so that was my number. That was my number three. So it seems like we're picking on him because we're bringing up another one, but we're going back to the Rock. Tell us about it.
Okay, so do y'all remember the song Pie? It literally, first of all, I think it had Slick Rick in the video. He had a Chinese dude in the video, but literally it was just the Rock just talk. It was literally just him. You know, like catchphrase saying pie. It wasn't. It's like, oh my God.
All right, here we go.
Got a choir.
You know, the Rock's gonna tell you a little story. You ain't gonna believe it. But he's gonna tell you anyway.
Tell me.
It's tough to be the Rock. No. Shut your mouth. No. It really is. Even though the Rock is
it's a promo.
Mark just wants a piece of pie. You got any of that in this bakery?
I got every kind of pie you can think of, like a strawberry pie, blueberry pie, apple pie.
No. Whoa. Actually, Slick, it doesn't matter what type of pie you have. Let the Rock tell you a little story about pie. Driving down south, though quickly aroused, when my car caught a fire near this old farmhouse.
hope somebody's home.
Niggas old farmhouse. You hear how they kind of mixed in? Can you smell what the Rock is cooking theme into the beat, though?
He get an A for the choir.
We will play more of it, but we're trying not to be demonetized.
We're gonna shut it down.
Now this, our number two, we get to come together on, cause it's one of the greatest worst things that has ever fucking happened in the history of wrestlers trying to make music. You know how they say, like, rappers want to be athletes, athletes want to be rappers. Wrestler, because that's him kind of wanted to be a little bit of both. This one, we're not even going to preview. We're just going to go ahead and play this crap. Ready? Ready? Boom.
I'm Kurt Hennig
and Big Scott Hall. Tag team champs, we'll take on them all.
So bring on the Long Riders, those dirt ball dumbos.
We'll smear those bushes, use the Wrestle Rock rumble.
The best part, everybody ends their verse like that, though. They got a thing. Everybody got a, or yo, or some shit. Wait for it. It's coming up. It's going to be better. Whose verse is that? I didn't realize they stressed it out there for it. Well, here we go.
This is Ken Resnick, and I'm here to say we've got the greatest wrestlers in the AWA. But you're not here to listen to me mumble and fill you in on the Wrestle Rock Rumble. Get on!
He was off beat. Get on!
Oh, God, I forgot they were there to shut.
You don't have to worry. We're not going to bumble because we'll be taking you to the Wrestle Rock Rumble.
Oh! Well, we get, I want to get to my favorite. Great guy.
Oh, God,
my favorite. He's hilarious. He be so amped, though. That's why I like Greg Guy, because he be so amped for this shit. He mean that shit, bro.
I'm Jerry Blackwell, and I want to see. I want to get my hands on that pencil neck geek. As I watch the EDF fumble, I'm going to make my splash in the Wrestle Rock Rumble.
So far, at bat, they're funny.
I'm Greg Gagne, and I'm in a rage. I want Brody, and I want him in a cage. I have planned drop kicks for making him see double. I grind him up at the Wrestle Rock Rumble. Woo!
Woo! He meant that shit. He meant that.
I want Brody. My name is Greg Gagne. I'm in a rage. I want Brody in the cage. I don't think you really want that, but all right. Ask Lex. Okay. All right, folks. We're down to the end of the list. That was a combo pick there. All right. So now that we're down to the end of the list, we're on our last one. Our last ones. They're both the same shithead we like. We love shitting on here. Mr. It's not hot himself. Shithead Hogan. So your Shithead Hogan, I think these are both from the same album, by the way.
The Hulk Rules album.
Which he did not. He did not. So let's play the first. Oh God. Let's see.
Which one are you playing?
Hulkster in the House.
Oh my God. It did also the video too, and he used to be in a band.
You know, why is it so he played the bass
guitar.
He played, because that's what he played, with the bass in the band.
I know, but it's so badly produced. That's the one thing you should be good
then
at.
Then the part that killed me is that is that every song had Hulk in it.
Yeah,
it's like nepotism, motherfucker. Here we go. So let's start with your first one on here.
Check him out, check him out.
Yeah, you got me saying that.
Get up off your seat. He's got a brand new beat. When the going gets tough, the tough get rough. Hey, oh, oh, come on, let's go. Hey, oh, oh, come on, let's go.
Let's not go. Let's not.
We'll stay far away.
Very, 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 very much far away. Now, my next one is my favorite, because not only does Hulkster let you know he's back, there's Hulksters in heaven, and this Hulkster's in the house. This Hulkster wants you to be a Hulkamaniac, and he got some bars to bring you in, too. We're going to play it for you right now. And our last of the Mount Rushmore, I want to be a Hulk, a maniac.
Oh, Lord.
Here we go. It is like the opening theme of like an entertainment show from 1990. Jimmy Hart has something to do with this bullshit.
Yeah.
Do you hear this cheese ass hook?
If you want to be a Hulk maniac, I can sure tell you how to stay on track. You gotta train, say your prayers, eat your vitamins too. These are all the things that the maniacs do. Positive thoughts and positive deeds. These are the things that make you succeed. Always be good to your family and friends.
These are the things that make you succeed.
The reason it makes me laugh so hard is because I can imagine the battle they can have on like Caffeine or on Smack with Macho Man and Hulk Hogan's bars. You ever seen like those videos on YouTube where people would take like, they'll loosely change some actual rapper's bars, like Little Baby, but then they'll fit it over like a gangster looking verse on like Mickey, and he'll be battling against like Goofy or some shit like that. It could be like that. Either way, I don't care. I'll take it. Just that's my point.
He has promos like that. Him and Hulk actually have some promos. They have a mega power to actually have them seeming like that.
Wow.
I thought too, I think him and Ultimate Warrior, I think they had like the most like coked up promo ever. Ever.
Oh, God. Okay. All right. So let's get into the show this week. We can get out of here. It's 7:48. Got about 45 minutes till the show is over. Let's finish it up, Plano.
All right. Start with Monday Night Raw. We start this off with Judgment Day. Mine is Dominic Mysterio, who is your new North American champion. He beat Wes Lee last week thanks to outside interference, mainly from Rhea Ripley. Ripley, but... KO and Sami Zayn come down, and Sami basically just keep talking, and he finally let Kevin talk, and Kevin basically said, drive people who don't learn a lesson, now Dom can't learn a lesson, so the best thing he can do is shut his mouth forever. That leads to a title match between Sami Zayn and Dominic Mysterio for tonight. Next we get Zoe Stark versus Becky Lynch. Becky wins, she gets Trish. She loses, she gotta get the Thank You Trish tattoo. Becky wins this match with the manhandle slam at the 10-minute mark. She almost lost again the same way they tried to cheat the week before with the distraction. She gets rolled up, but fortunately that don't work that time. Next, we get Brock Lesnar, who took out Cody Rhodes in front of his mom last week. Next, we get Cody Rhodes, who's here for a chat. He talked about how Brock beat him down. It wasn't on his bucket list. He talked about Lesnar got everything handed to him so fast from his time in NFL to the UFC. See, he said the same mother that, though he went far when he beat him down in front of his mom, the same mother that watched Terry Funk throw fireballs at Dusty Rhodes, then went drinking with Gordon Soleil. Then now Cody is slapping the bear in the face. He wanted Brock to bring it at SummerSlam. Next we get Logan Paul going with Ricochet. Ricochet said he... will say what he think of Logan Paul to his face. Next, we get the North American title match with Sami Zayn versus Dominic Mysterio. This match started to pick up a little bit at the end. After Dom drop kicks Sami. Sami for Blue Thunder Bomb. 619 attempt gets Dom a 2. 3 amigos. Zayn with a superplex into the corner. Priest Ripley jump KO on the stage. Dominic rolls up Zayn. They ain't get the win at the 12-minute mark. He's basically the honky-tonk man right now. Somebody said in terms of, like, his championships, he just gonna win them. He retains them all by cheating. Next, we get Ricochet. He asked Shinsuke, hey, seen Logan Paul. Nakamura said he'll tell Ricochet if he's seen him before a turnaround to see Tomoko Ciampa. Nakamura got shot in on Ciampa. He said that's his free one. Nakamura gets involved, they got a problem. Next we get Tommaso Ciampa versus Bronson Reed. Shinsuke comes in for a distraction, which allowed Reed to win with the tsunami at the 12-minute mark. We're going to get a showdown with Nakamura versus Ciampa Next, we get Rhea Ripley attacking Raquel Rodriguez and Liv Morgan, which led to them losing the tag team titles. Morgan says she's ready to beat up Ripley tonight. She said even if she get taken out, maybe she doesn't. But with Morgan gone, Chelsea Green and Sonya Deville coming to ask why they aren't being interviewed. That would be because they don't have a match tonight. Ripley comes there to stare them off. Now we get a non-title match. Liv Morgan gets jumped during her entrance again. Then her arm get pillowized despite refs and meds being there. Ripley does it for a second time. This is the right Liv off because she actually re-injured her shoulder. Shoulder that she just came back from, which sucks for Liv. Next we get the Alpha Academy wants the Alpha Academy Royal match with the Viking Raiders. Maxxine Dupree about to face Valhalla in her first singles match. Ricochet called out Logan Paul and said Paul don't believe here. He called him a little prick who don't deserve to be here. People are here every week sacrificing to get their spot, but Paul just think he can do whatever he want. Challenges on for SummerSlam. Paul comes out from behind and steps the challenge. And then as he's on his phone, Ricochet hits him with a super kick before taking a picture with him. Next, Shane Baszler said they're going to fight at SummerSlam. Logan Paul said that's unprofessional. He's coming for Ricochet next week. Next, we get Damian Priest versus Apollo Crews. Damian Priest wins this match at the three-minute mark. Becky Lynch says not over with Trish until she wins. The Valhalla and Viking Raiders accept the match. Imperial is here for a face-to-face with Drew McIntyre. The challenge for Eric Cardona title match tonight, but Gunnar said he'd save it for SummerSlam. He humiliated him at SummerSlam. He brings up how the match with Drew, talking about how he knows Sheamus for years now. He said their dream face at WrestleMania. He said they did that this year, but Gunnar snuck in and stole the win. Gunther think Kyler should lead Imperial, but he'll set up for a match. This lead to a match. McIntyre wins for Claymore at like the 10-minute mark. It was a good match. They basically beat the hell out of each other. He's obviously behind Gunther. He's obviously the second best one with like in-ring ability behind Gunther. And it shows. They triple team him. Riddle comes in for a save. It don't work. He gets beat up. Eventually McIntyre fights back and powerbombs Gunther to the announce table. Finn is here to sign a contract with Seth Rollins. He said they can handle this like gentlemen, so Adam Pearce not here. Rollins is quite the Sergey. Of course, they sing his song again, like always. I love how, like, it's Finn Balor. I love how he just makes, like, a minimum of, like, 4 minutes of the crowd just going. Just because and you see Finn's face. He gets upset. He's no longer, what you used to call him, Irish Pac? Or White Pac?
Yeah, White Pac.
Yeah, he ain't that no more. He ain't got that bandana with him no more.
Oh, that's the end of an era.
Yeah, so Rollins said that they can just sign and maybe Balor wins, but he said as soon as he wins, Damon's going to cash in on him. Balor hesitated before signing, saying Rollins think he has everything figured out. Judgment Day come and said, feel like a helpless 7-year itch. It's an itch that you can't scratch, a 7-year itch. He said at SummerSlam, Rollins become the 7-year bitch. Rollins turned the table, then gets beat down. Sami Zayn tried to make the save. That don't work. And the beatdown is what ends the show. That's the end of Raw. Reason KO wasn't there, because I think they said KO has a legitimate injury. So, you're talking about that. They might
drop the belt to SummerSlam, from what I hear.
Either that, or they're going to try, or Sammy's going to find another partner, you know. Mm-hmm. Probably like KO's blessing, something like that.
Gotcha.
So.
NXT, sir?
Man, might as well get NXT out the way before I finish with SmackDown. Well, you got some shows you got in between there, so. Next, we get NXT. This is the go-home show for Great American Bash. Judgment Day is there again. Of course, as I mentioned, Dominic is the new North American champion. We get a final showdown between Hayes and Dragunov before their title match. Dominic and Ripley are here. They talk about how everything is going. They talk about how great each other is. Lyra Valkyrie comes out here. Wes Lee comes out here. Lee said he hates seeing Dominic hold that title. Mustafa Ali comes out and said he respects Lee, but not Dominic. He said he wanted a chance to be North American title, but Dominic stole it. Lee doesn't like that. They go back and forth. Ali saying, you're stupid for even defending the title against him when you know that I was next in line. Line, Ali swings at Dom. He hits Lee. Dom says, excuse me, champ coming through. They brawl. Dominic and Ripley run away. Next, Tony D'Angelo and Stack said they're coming for them tag team titles. We get Lucien Price, Price and Bronco Nima. They said they want a match for the belts too, so they get a match. Laura Valkyrie challenged Rhea Ripley. She said she's been here for 7 months. She know where she stands. She's not gonna stand in the shadow like JC James because people need to see who she is. Next, we get Carmelo Hayes, Trick Williams, and here go Dragunov versus Schism. Everything, get to the match.
Gacy and the Grizzle Young Vets.
Yeah. Everything.
He said it so sad. He's like, yeah.
Everything broke down. When Dragunov goes outside, misses a charge. Williams gets sent to the steps. Fowler takes over Dragunov, who chops his way out of freedom. To freedom, everything breaks down. Some of the Schism followers pull Reed and Fowler down. Hayes tags himself in, finishes Gacy with the nothing but net at the 12-minute mark. We get a video on Tiffany Stratton, who says she is awesome and she's not sweating a submission match against Thea Hale. Next, we get Von Wagner versus Javier Bernal. Guess how long this match ended?
40 seconds.
No, I'm in it too.
I was only up about 26 seconds.
Post-match, Wagner puts him, through the announce table, only to get blindsided by Bron Breakker. So Bron Breakker basically beats the hell out of him, and he basically just beating the hell out of Wagner with the chair, Trick goes to Dragunov at the back after Dragunov threatened to break him. Hayes said he has this, but Williams won't Dragunov tonight. He said he's going to call him out tonight. This was after Gabe Stevenson is here for his big decision. List off some accomplishments. Guess who cuts him off? Baron Corbin. Said he needs...
I was kind of hoping you were going to say go get Joe Gacy because I feel like that would have irritated you more, but...
Right. Baron Corbin says Stevenson needs to go back to college. It's a place full of sharks. Stevenson said he needs to leave before he get hurt. Then challenges on for Great American Bash, and then Corbin eats some suplexes. So
how's he looking?
Really ain't seen no action for him, really. That's the crazy. That's a lot of bumps. It's like his first match. It's going to be kind of like one of them, like...
Here's my question of why I mainly asked this. Because I feel like it's strange that... To be somebody who was actually in wrestling, like you know, professional Olympic Greco-Roman wrestling, it feel like it's taken him a long-ass time to take to this shit because they haven't put him on TV, but they announced him like 2 or 3 years ago.
Yeah.
While you have the likes of Logan Paul or Bad Bunny who take to this shit after 3 months of training. Yeah. Can you explain that?
I can't explain it. I mean, the only thing I can explain is basically that, like, He still thought about going back to wrestling for his senior season and I don't know. It seemed like he got a lot of stuff on his plate right now that I guess I don't want to say he's not focusing much as on the wrestling. He probably not focusing on that much as he should, seeing that you're signed to them. I mean, I don't know. I mean, hell, you got the Cadaver Twins at the Performance Center about to try to get into wrestling themselves.
And they just came over from NCAAs and whatever they're doing there.
Yep. Next,
and somehow I still feel like they may debut. Well, Gable Stevens is on NXT now.
He's gonna debut next week against Baron Corbin.
But I'm saying though, I was about but to say like, at this rate, the Contender Twins are gonna fucking debut before him.
next we get Yo Girl Dana Brooke versus Cora Jade in a Singapore Kane match. Kalani James is here with Dana Brooke. Basically, they start off by fighting. They get side. Jade throws a bunch of sticks, slam Brooks onto all of them, running knee, hit Brooks in the face, but she gets out of her own. The handspring elbow in the corner, fell bulldog. Jordan gets a distraction where Brooks sends Jade into a chair. Brooke gets the kendo stick, slams her onto the chair, and hits a swanton for the win. Dana Brooke just beat Cora Jade.
I was going to ask, like, are they going to give her a win down there yet or what?
So there you go. I was wrong.
Yeah. Also, too, this is a live volume match. Them kendo stick shots hurt it. Like, you just hurt it. What's the name? Like, next, Hayes warns Dragunov about Trick going to call him out. Dragunov is saying he's found that, but it ain't going to be for a match. He said he will break Williams and he'll break Hayes at the Great American Bash. Your boy, Gabagoo. With Charles Dempsey, they train with Miles Bourne, who don't impress them. Damon Kemp comes in and says he wants to train with them. Okay. Brock Onima and Lucien Price versus Tony D'Angelo and Stax. Scripps is on commentary for this match. That's all Reggie. We all know. He's been unmasked. X-Time goes after Scripps for the distraction. D'Angelo comes in and clean house. The Bada Bing finished them at the 5-minute mark. Scripps actually made commentary more annoying. You know how you bring people out to commentary and they ask some kind of what's that? He made that shit more annoying. Sad. Gallus pops up, said they're retaining Sunday. Dijak said he's ready to hurt Eddie Thorpe. Zion Clark gets shown in the crowd. Apparently he's an MMA fighter. And then we get some cell phone footage. So I guess they so you know how Booker T and Stone Cold had that little fight thing in the grocery store?
Yeah.
They did something like this, except it was a convenience store. And Roxanne Perez basically beat the shit out of Blair Davenport in this store. Cops got called. She run out right when the cops, like, arrived and everything like that. It was... I thought that's some, like, Booker T had something to do with that. Just because. You know.
I bet he definitely had comments on it. He has comments on seemingly everything.
Now we get for the Supernova session with the Metaphor. Their guest is Noam Dar. They talk about how he lost the cup. He's still depressed. Nathan Frazier comes out with the real cup. Dragon Lee said Dar's a fraud. Out comes Lucia Leon and Valentine for Ross to take out the women. Frazier and Lee clears the ring. Next, we get Humberto Carrillo and Angel Garza. They officially split up after they lost last week.
Where the hell have they been at?
I think that when one was hurt, then the other one came back and got hurt, too, so they never been helped at the same time.
Okay.
Got it. Next, we get Valkyrie versus Rhea Ripley, non-title match. This, probably Rhea Ripley here. 10-minute match, great 10-minute match. She did her job. She gave her some rub. You know, like, she looked real good in this match. In this match, of course, the Riptide's how she wins this match. She made Valkyrie look like a star. You know, she's not good enough to hang with Rhea Ripley. But with more time, she could be a future player in the women's division at NXT. And after the match, Ripley basically tells her, prove her right and beat JC James. So, like. Then we get to our main. Not even our main event, our main segment of the show. Trick Williams comes out here. He calls on Dragunov, who comes straight down. Soon as Dragunov comes down, I mean, Trick Williams hops off the rope and hit him with a drop kick. Dragunov fight back with chops in the corner. Big right hand to the face. He about to go for the torpedo. Hayes comes in. Takes the torpedo for Trick Williams. And then, I like what he said at the end. He said, you know, I admire you. He's like, he said, you're loyal to your friends. He like, well, after Great American Bash, he said, make sure you still be loyal to your friend. Because that's the only thing you're going to have is your friend. And I take the NXT title from you. And that's the end of NXT. So.
Alrighty. It is my half of the docket over on AEW Dynamite. Not just any Dynamite. It is Blood and Guts. Show starts off with the FTW title match. Champion Hook taking on Jungle Boy. Oh, so you thought. As the title screen came on for his entrance music, it was cut short. We saw, basically, who is Jungle Boy? He had on a leather jacket, and he was dragging somebody who had on Jungle Boy's boots into, like, a grave he dug in the desert. And Jungle Boy is no more. That's dead and buried. We now have FTW title match between Hook versus Jack Perry.
Nice.
Yeah, he comes down as himself in a leather jacket. This one comes down to distraction. Referee took a bump. So Hook had a head and arm suplex, but he got a no count on it. Jack Perry gets up, hits him with the belt, and steals the title with 11 minutes and 38 seconds. You have a new FTW champion, Jack Perry. Next up, Chris Jericho and Don Cass had a meeting, but security got in front of the camera, so they blocked him. Said it was private. Next, so Adam Cole went to a restaurant last night where MJF got to face two of his biggest fears, spicy food and poor people. They sit down and MJF tells a story about slamming a 600-pound Big Bill in front of 95,000 Maximaniacs. But then the food gets really spicy. They drink a lot to kill the spice, but they realize they drank 100% alcohol. Later, Max tells the Big Bill story again. Then he thinks the waiter looks like Daniel Garcia or maybe Sammy Garcia. One thing they still left to do is the double clothesline. So they double clotheslined the waiter.
Oh. Poor waiter.
Don Callis and Jericho arrive again, and they basically call Alice Marvin as an idiot. Next up, Britt Baker makes her return to the ring in a squash match. She wins in a minute and 6 seconds with a lockjaw against some local chick named Kayla Sparks. MJF and Adam Cole are ready to win the tag titles, and plan A is the double clothesline. MJF says, quote, unlike Sammy Guevara's wife, we don't need a plan B.
Ouch.
They even have matching trunks and jackets. Plus one more surprise from Adam Cole.
Okay, MJF, I'm stuffed with that one.
So they both leave off as they show Roger Strong still wearing a neck brace, chasing after Adam Cole, still kind of salty that they're cool together. And then we get that match, Blind Eliminator Tag Tournament Finals. Daniel Garcia and Sammy Guevara taking on MJF and Adam Cole, baby. And yes, they do get off. They do get off double clothesline at some point in time.
Oh, he was so happy.
They did it to win the match at that. So first they set it up. They set it up with the Panama Sunrise into the double clothesline, and then they pinned Daniel Garcia.
Nice.
After about 10 minutes and 40 seconds, a pretty good match. Nice back and forth, but we knew this was headed. So now you're going to have FTR taking on Cole and MJF. The seeds have already been planted in last week's match, or might have been during this match. No, it was more during last week's match. So basically, the seeds have been planted for the turn, because at one point in time during the match, somebody threw the AEW title into the ring during last week's match. And they, like, Cole had picked it up because he was going to use it. And MJF just stared at him, like, with this, you know how he is. He's like Gollum with the ring over the AEW title. So he saw him with it, and he instantly was about to, like, turn on him quick. And he was like, no. They were about to hit us with it. Like, chill. So he finally got him to calm down, and they won the match. But he still had this look, even though after they hugged after the match, like, you son of a bitch. That was kind of the look on his face. So the seeds have been planted, so we'll see where it goes. It ends up leading back to their one-on-one for the title. Post-match, Guevara and Garcia walk away from Jericho, who was on commentary for the match when he tried to congratulate him after the match. With the villains going to ref hands. Oh, here it goes. Once they left the ring, the ref handed Cole the title instead of MJF. And when MJF saw that, he fucking flipped. Or he looked like he was about to fucking flip. Cue FTR for big stare downs in the ring, and everybody leaves. Then we have the participants of the Rampage Rumble, or Royal Rampage, I should call it. Darby Allin, Nick Wayne, Orange Cassidy, Chris Statlander. Well, she's actually not in that, but she has a match on there. And she's with the Best Friends, obviously. They all talk about their respective matches that are coming up on that show. Allin owes AR Fox a favor and gives him an international title shot next week. Though he didn't have that belt. I don't know why they said that. But anyway, everybody put their hands in except for Darby Allin and Nick Wayne. You know, Shark Week, so they show Chompy the Shark dancing. Next up, Blood and Guts, our main event, which is about an hour-long match. First, Blackpool Combat Club comes out. The first member of it is for Blackpool Combat Club, Claudio Castagnoli. Starts off the match with
Castagnoli, taking on Kenneth Omega. They basically come out battling each other first. You know how these goes. Blood and Guts is the same as on War Games, where basically everybody comes down to their 5-on-5. Then we have the match beyond, where everything really kicks off. So let's go with the order that Cats came down. BBC, or BCC, I should say, has the man advantage. So Moxley was the first one. Let me see. No, I'm wrong. Hold on. First was Omega. Then after Omega was Pac. That's who came down. They made it 2-1. Then Hangman Page came down. Then Moxley came down. Then Nick Jackson came down. Then Wheeler Yuta came down. The other Jackson came down. And your final two were Kachesca. And Kota Ibushi was the last one to come to the ring. That made it 5-on-5 in the match beyond. This match was great because you get your typical tropes, but they added some others. This is one of my favorites. So at some point in time, and I'm not exactly sure how the fuck they got out the ring, because nobody else got out the ring the entire match, but Matt Jackson and Wheeler Yuta got the ring and were battling each other like on the ramp, and both somehow climbed to the top, and then Beck and the other one like, come on, little bitch, come up here. So they go up there. Matt Jackson does his rolling suplexes on top of the double cage. So that was cool. At some point in time while he was up there, he threatened to throw Wheeler Yuta off. That didn't end up happening. But somehow he got tacks, like a bag of tacks, and dumped them through the top of the cage. So they just sprinkled down to the ring like rain. So eventually somebody went into those, obviously. And then Moxie brought out the glass again. This time he had a whole bunch of sugar glass. Cats was all catching that left and right. I thought that you could tell it was sugar glass just because I felt like it should have cut them up more, and it didn't. You didn't get as many scars from that. You got more scars from, like, you know, thumbtacks being stuck in cats and shit like that, which was interesting. Eventually, when it came down to it at the end, somehow they got Moxley handcuffed in the corner. After a great battle of going back and forth, eventually people started getting isolated. At some point in time during the match, Pat caught an inadvertent shot from a teammate, and he got pissed. He said, you know what, fuck this. And he literally went under the ring, grabbed the bolt cutters, cut that bitch, and just walked off like, fuck y'all. So that made it 5-4 at this point. So that's when you can see the seeds happening, like, uh-oh, I don't know about BBC winning this one, or BCC. Anyway, so back to the match. Eventually, Moxie gets handcuffed in the corner, and as he's handcuffed, they're taking out different members of the team. You know, I remember it's 5-on-4. They already took out Kachesca. He's out the way. They took out Claudio. They had him isolated. They got it down to Wheeler Yuta. Do you remember the match with Moxley versus Hangman Page where Moxley tapped to the chain?
Yeah.
Moxley tapped for Yuta with the same thing. They had Wheeler in the chain pulling back on him. Wheeler didn't tap. Moxley tapped for him because he couldn't do nothing to help save him because he was handcuffed in the corner.
Right.
And he was already... It was funny. He said somebody during the match, when the refs, the commentator said, oh, there goes Moxley bleeding again. And he did an ends and Y. So, of course, he's in the corner bleeding, or blood drying on him at this point. And he has to give up for Yuta. So the match goes to the Golden Elite. They take Blood and Guts this year. And that was the end of Dynamite. To save you a break before you go into SmackDown, I'm going to roll over to the Royal Rampage, since I'm already on a roll here. The Royal Rampage, some participants for this match. Murder Grandpa, Minoru Suzuki.
I love Murder Grandpa.
He was there, got to play his whole theme too. We also had Jay Lethal was in the match. Slap Nuts was in the match. Nick Wayne
Hold on. We got to do this the right way. You can't just call him Slap Nuts.
Well, the reason I threw it out like that is because it was a major moment. No, it's not that, because it's the Royal Rumble, so I just wanted to mention all the participants. But okay. Hold on. There's a wild Slap Nuts on the loose. Dent.
J-E-double-F-J-A-double-R-E to double T. Jump Jerk.
Anyway.
Look, Slap Nuts.
So, Nick Wayne, you remember the two rings. There's a ring with red ropes, there's a ring with blue ropes. So the blue ring, the red ring. Minoru Suzuki, Brian Cage, Big Bill, Darby Allin, Ethan Page, Commander. They were all in this. Swerve Strickland was in this.
No, Jericho wasn't in it, but Money Matt was in it, and
it was the nipples hard.
I don't check for that shit. Money Matt was in it. Anthony LaParker was in it, and finally dumping that big dumbass purple hat. Oh God, we the people. He was in it too. He's not on TV enough for me to remember his damn name at the moment.
We call him We the People.
Well, I mean, you know who I'm talking about when I say this shit. You had the Gates of Agony. Both of those dudes were in it also. Toa Leona and Bishop Khan. You also had Matt Sydal in it for a minute. He got eliminated quick. Matt Hardy was in it.
Shooting Star Press?
Not due to that.
No, I know.
Brother Zay was in it. All these cats don't really matter. The final two in the match was Darby Allin and Swerve Strickland. The ending was funny because, and this is going to lead to the feud, so I'm assuming this is why the ending went like this, but do you remember, was it a WrestleMania where Roman Reigns had speared Brock Lesnar through the cage and he won because Brock hit the ground first like that? Do you remember that?
Was that a Mania?
I don't remember if it was a Mania, but you remember a moment I'm talking about it was a cage match with Roman Reigns and Brock Lesnar. He speared him through the cage. Roman won because Brock hit the floor first. This is like a couple years ago. Either way, here's my point. So that basically just happened again in this match without the cage.
Oh.
Darby Allin threw himself through the ropes. You know he throws his body into a bandit all the time. He did that against Swerve. Swerve was trying to hold on to the ropes, you know what I'm saying? And they both spiked outside, but Swerve hit first. So they called Darby Allin the winner. But they're both to face one-on-one on the next Dynamite coming up next week. So we'll see. We'll see what my kid. Hitting my mic, and I just did it again inadvertently, trying to talk about hitting my mic. I'm an idiot. Anyway, we'll see where this goes. So I'm assuming this will lead to a feud where somehow the spot for that match, that title match, is going to be on the line because the winner gets a shot at the TNT title, basically. Christian Cage or Luchasaurus or whichever you want to call it.
I know, yeah.
We'll get back to that on Collision.
I'm trying to remember that. But I know, I do remember, I don't know if it was wrong, but I do remember it was a match between, like, that match between Vince McMahon and Stone Cold and Big Show.
Yeah, then that was another one.
Big Show basically threw Stone Cold through the goddamn cage when Stone Cold won the match. And Vince was fucking pissed.
Yeah, so basically, okay, this is basically, the reason he won is because he went through the ropes and not over the ropes while Swerve went over the ropes.
Oh.
But I can still see them leading to, like, you didn't really beat me or whatever. So, next up on the show is the Acclaimed and Billy Gunn versus QT Marshall. We'll talk more about these. We'll talk more about the Acclaimed on Dynamite. I mean, on Collisions, because the interesting development happened from there. Your boy Court in the TV. The part that made me mad about this match, because Jericho was on commentary, and he had them on an episode of Talking Jericho recently, and had the nerve to try to be like, oh, Hardy Cameron, she's such a great singer, and she's a great rapper, which makes everyone mad. We're mad because she can't rap, but she keep acting like she can. Knock off Iggy Azalea ass. Anyway, so the Acclaimed win this one. Max Caster hits the mic drop.
We are the victory.
he also cut some of his best back. He dropped some weak ones, I said, last week. He stepped it back up this week. He said Harley Cameron reminds him of Rosa B from Arby's. he said some other stuff on there that was, it was pretty good.
Arby's. Oh, my God.
There was some other pretty good ones.
Send me daddy ass. Not the funny part of it. That part just funny to me.
Next up is your main event of the show. Is TBS title match Marina Shafir the problem taking on champion Chris Statlander? My
girl, the alien. That was the main event.
Yep, it was a title on the line. It should be the main event, or at least that's how I feel. You got gold on the line, so you should be in the main event. She wins the match after about 5 minutes with the Friday Night Fever, which is basically a Spike version of Undertaker Tombstone. For the most part. And as the end of Rampage, as we have about 10 to 12 minutes left here in the show, let's knock off the last two shows.
SmackDown. Let's start it off with Jey Uso. Uso, but Bloodline cut him off. He said he made the right man hand because he had that kind of power. Do Jey think he could run the place? Jey said, I stood behind you for years now. He said, I didn't break the family. You broke the family. Ray said it's Jay's fault and that Jay was on the right man hand because Jimmy was hurt. Was hurt. Right as what happened, the thing gets crazy and Jay beat them. He like, but nah, because Jay can't do it. Jay like, I already beat you and I'll do it again at SummerSlam. Jay runs to Grayson Waller, who offers to give him the Grayson Waller rub.
Jay just basically just bitch slapped him and walks off. Next, we get Rey Mysterio versus Santo Escobar for a future U.S. title shot.
Wait, are they still cool?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, well, just,
friendly rivalry.
Yeah, because they both won the two tournaments for the 44 tournament.
I was hoping Santos would turn heel, but all right.
So, basically, this match got scary towards the end because, Escobar does a dive that, like, through the ropes as they go to the break. But as they come back from break, the trainers are checking on Rey. Rey, he hit his head on the landing real bad, so they basically stopped the match at the 15-minute mark. Escobar gets the win. A lot of people were saying it was a work, but then after we find out, no. Rey literally did get legitimately got hurt in that match, which sucks. He checks on Rey. He pays homage. He's basically like in tears about what happened. Bianca Belair says she's ready to win her title back. Grand Deville interrupts her, makes fun of her for not having the title no more. She said, "I'll fight both of y'all," but guess who comes to her defense? Charlotte Flair. She said, "Because I want you at 100%, so we'll do the tag." She's literally like, "We'll do the tag thing." That's literally how she said it. Hit Row comes to mock the fans.
They're here now.
L.A. Knight, yeah. In a rough, probably the best jab ever. He like, you know what? He was like, man, we knew Will Smith was a rapper in the game. He like, but I didn't know Uncle Phil was a rapper neither. Talking about, and he like, and we all know B-Fab wants some of this. But Ashanti, that you can get dropped on your head next, though. This lead to a match. Knight wins this match with the blunt force trauma at a minute and 30 seconds. Jey Uso gets told he got to face Grayson Waller tonight. Bobby Lashley with the Street Profits backstage. He said he likes the team, but they need to dress better. Well, he said Dawkins at least needs to. Give them some nice suits. Next, we get Bianca Belair versus Charlotte. Charlotte versus Deville and Green. Green, you know how this match go. KOD loaded up. Charlotte tags herself in. Kicks Green in the face for the delay of the win. So it's the two opponents trying to one-up each other, basically what this match was. Now they're arguing. Now we get another argument. And this is Io Sky backstage. She asking Bayley, like, why did you leave so fast last week? Last week, Bayley said, she's like, I just want to leave quickly before finding a note from Shotzi on her bag. They rush to leave, but Asuka comes in and promises to retain at SummerSlam. Scott takes the cash in, then they leave. We're going to have a SummerSlam Battle Royal, which starts from Raw SmackDown. Wasn't our answer talking about Battle Royals. LA Knight, yeah, said that he wants in the Battle Royal. The Brawling Brutes come in and mock him.
Yeah, you're on the ground.
Next we get your boy Karl Anderson versus Karrion Kross. Yeah, he loses this match in like 2 minutes.
I'm guessing you mean Machine Gun Karl, right?
Yeah. The finisher was he changed his finisher, so it's like a power slam, which he swings into a DDT. He calls it the final prayer. I don't know. Next, we get Jey Uso versus Grayson Waller. My phone just rusted in. There you go. Again, Grayson Waller with the trolling. So he hits a springboard elbow. Then does the people's elbow, but he does it like 3 times as long as The Rock would do one. He basically just joking around and everything like that. Well, do you remember when John Cena tried to do the same thing and it ended bad, The Rock with a kip up and a rock bottom and he takes his title?
How he ended up winning the match on their face.
Well, he tries
the first time, right?
Well, he tries to do that. Jay comes up with a super kick, but he tries for the Rolling Stunner, another super kick. He hits a spear, which is like probably the worst spear. Okay, do you remember when Christian tried to hit the spear as a tribute to Edge?
Yeah.
It looked so bad.
Yeah, I remember. Wasn't that match against Randy Orton? Yeah.
I think Jay Uso might be worser. Splash, Superfly Splash ends with 11 minutes. It wasn't about to match. Post-match, Solo runs down and beat Jay, but he misses the spike. Jay hits a super kick. Reigns come in. He gets speared too. Solo breaks up the Splash again, lays out Jay with the spear spike combo that puts him down. They do it again. Again. And that's the end of SmackDown.
All right.
One of SmackDown weakest shows. Because SmackDown been putting on some bangers like the last couple months. This is one of their weaker shows, though. Probably because it's leading up to a go-home show, so they probably ain't trying to, like, you know, throw everything out.
My guess is your main event next week is going to be Solo versus Jay.
Could be.
All right, let's get to our last show of the week so we can get out of here. Close to being on time. That comes down to me. Talking about AEW Collision. So, you know how the show, it usually opens up with the main components of the show giving a quick line about what's going to happen on the show. So, this week they had the trio titles were on the line. So, open up with the Acclaim talking about that. CM Punk was talking about getting some revenge. And Ricky Stark was coming out feeling like money. With the new Gucci bag because he won the Owen Hart. So that's what the show starts with, is with Tony Schiavone in the ring with Ricky Stark. He's more excited about his new bag that he bought for himself. As he starts talking, CM Punk comes out. He didn't even come out with music. He just literally walks down to the ring. He didn't even cut him off with Cult of Personality. So he says, you know, you got your belt, you know, you got your, you know, Owen Hart title, and you won a trophy. But tell me, can you live yourself with getting your victory that way? You know what I'm saying? So basically, if Starks is just like, I don't really care. I'm just trying to stack up wins around here. And since you call yourself a champion, why don't you put what you got in the red bag on the line? CM Punk makes some comment about Little Max or something like that. Comes out next, Christian Cage. Not sure why he interrupted, of all people.
You said who?
Christian Cage is kind
of... Yo!
If you look into my eyes... You're going to distract me with that shit, Clint. Anyway.
Hold on.
Do it again.
Oh, you be done. That's a boy right there. I don't care. The underrated theme song. I don't care what nobody say.
Anyway. That piece of shit. Anyway. So... So this causes Darby Allin to come out. Darby Allin comes out, talks about, because Ricky Starks, draws him out the fact that Ricky Starks mentioned something about the Pillars and said he's better than any of the Pillars could ever be. Which, if you look at the track records, I'm like, I saw the Jungle Boy, you're wrong. It's like, cause all the rest of them have held titles or multiple titles, and one of them has been a world champion, so I don't know if you can say that, but anyway. He comes out and says, you know, I believe anybody here in this company could be a Pillar, so don't hit me with that Pillar shit. But he basically came out to challenge Christian and says, Christian, you don't wrestle anymore, so why don't you just give me that TNT championship or let me face the actual champion, Luchasaurus or whatever. This basically leads to them making a tag team match for later in the show, and the main event player, Ricky Starks and Christian Cage, not Luchasaurus, taking on CM Punk and Darby Allin. From there, you have Andrade Elo trying to get into the ring, or get to the ring, so he can holler
at...
Elo!
Oh, I was about to say, what's his name? What did,
Ian Riccoboni say?
Yeah.
Andrade Idalo.
Idalo.
Anyway, so Idalo, they wouldn't let him in the ring, wouldn't let him into the building because of what happened last week, him trying to confront the House of Black at the ring for still having his mask in their possession. Your next match is Axel Andretti and Darius Martin taking on Bullet Club Gold. Bullet Club Gold toy with them for 10 minutes before winning the match with the DDT just into a Blade Runner for the finish on Andretti. Next up, they show Willow Nightingale winning the women's Owen Hart. And then show her match with Athena, which we'll talk about next week, so we'll skip the results of that. Next up was a minute and 20-second match with the Redeemer, Miro, taking on the hip-hop hippo, Nick Camarado.
He's going to go home after he beat him and fuck his flexible wife, right?
Yep.
No, his double-jointed flexible wife.
Yep. Yeah. He beat the shit out of Nick Camarado, made him tap.
Oh,
in the game over in a minute 26 seconds. Trios titles match, House of Black versus the Acclaimed and Billy Gunn.
Acclaimed.
So this match, they had good bars. He had good bars coming out at first. And I forgot exactly what he said, so I can sit there and quote him. But the best part about it was he caught a V-trigger to the fucking mouth in the middle of the second verse from Murphy, because he was not on that shit.
He must have said something about Ripley.
They said, I don't know if he said something about Ripley. He just said some bar, and the crowd was like, ooh. Before he got to say the next line, it was whoop, right in the fucking face. He had to say
something about his girl.
Right in the fucking face. So they got their ass whooped from pillar to post right to beginning. This was a squash match. So for them to build this up for it to be a squash match was crazy. Black Mask to Billy Gunn leads to the victory. House of Black retains 4 minutes and 30 seconds. Now, the best part of this was the end of the match. Post-match, the House of Black, they all seen, well, outside of Brody King, they all seen to show respect to Billy Gunn. Like, Malakai Black gave him a hug. Murphy, like, tapped him on the shoulder after whispering some in his ear, and they all walked out the ring. The rest of the Acclaim were already beat up on the outside, just kind of looking on. Billy Gunn, all of a sudden, starts unlacing his boots. Right in the middle of the fucking ring. And the way he was doing it, I felt emotional watching him. Like, I think this is for real. I don't think this is a storyline. Because the way he was doing it, his hands were fucking shaking. Like, you could see it, like, in his face. Like, he felt, it looked like he wanted to cry, but he didn't. Like, I think this might be for, like, for real, maybe retirement for him. He totally unlaced his boots. The Acclaim tried to stop him from doing it, but he was like, no, move. And he walked right through them and walked up the ring after putting his boots in the middle of the ring. So we possibly have a retirement by Billy Gunn? I guess we'll find out later. FTR comes out for a chat, talking about defending their tag team titles next week against Adam Cole, MJF. They have unfinished business with a bunch of teams. At first, they had to get the deal done with these two. Wheeler gets to the fans like MJF and Cole at the moment, but he has first-hand experience dealing with MJF's lies. Harwood talks about having to get a job. When he was about 14 and having some rich kids that made fun of him for having to do work. He's always wanted to punch those kids in the face, but it brings him here where people like MJF take wrestling as a joke. They pause for a double clothesline champ before Harwood talks about how he doesn't like much of a joke. MJF and Cole are making wrestling. Next week, Harwood is giving them the beating they should have gotten when they were kids. Basically what they say. Next match, Sky Blue takes on Ty Valkyrie. Nice competitive match between the two, but throughout most of the match, you could tell who really had the upper hand. Ty Valkyrie wins this one with her curb stomp slash like Mexican submission move, where she looks like she's putting them like in a Mexican surfboard and then ends up pulling both arms back and doing the curb stomp. She basically just locks your legs up so you can't go anywhere and run. That's how it looks to me. And then she calls out Britt Baker after the match. Kind of a shaky, shitty promo, but I got her point nonetheless. And then we get your main event, which is Ricky Starks and Christian Cage taking on CM Punk and Darby Allin. The main point of this one came down to Ricky stacking up dubs. This match, they gave it some time, 25 minutes. I thought it went a little long. But the main point of the match was you got down to the end of the match. Luchasaurus broke up a coffin drop that was about to happen when it ends up to a roll-up exchange between Darby Allin and Starks. Starks grabs the final exchange on the roll-up and grabs the ropes again for the pin victory like he did to win the Owen Hart over CM Punk and then rolls away dancing with the victory as we end the show. And that also, as I roll away dancing right now because the end of our show. been a good one here with you, brother. We'll put together another one for you next week as we'll get it together here. But one half of your hosts, I've been Rob.
I'm Clint.
And this has been Hot Tag Wrestle Corner. Ron, send us home, sir.